Hi guys, today we will be discussing about how to approach a child with hematuria. If you like my lectures, please subscribe to my channel and discuss it with your colleagues so that they can also benefit from the lectures. Now on to the topic. How do you define a case of hematuria? If it is gross hematuria, it is very obvious. The blood and urine is visible to the eye. Remember, as small as 1 ml of blood in 1 liter of urine will make it visible to our naked eye. And the darkness of the urine is not equivalent to the severity of hematuria. Microscopic hematuria differs based upon whether you are looking at the uncentrifuged or a centrifuged urine and whether you are looking in terms of a high power field or in cubic millimeters. It is 5 RBCs. Remember, significant hematuria is defined when it is more than 50 RBCs per high power field. So, if a child is going to come to you complaining of red urine, nobody is going to come and tell you, see doctor, I am having a hematuria. No, everybody is going to come and tell you panicking that they have blood in urine. But you as a clinician need to know whether it is actually blood, something resembling blood or something else altogether. So, you have RBCs, which is actually hematuria. It can be hemoglobinuria or myoglobinuria. It can be something else, which is excess metabolites, drugs, toxins or dyes, or something is added after the urine has been passed, as in the example of Munchausen syndrome by proxy, where some caretaker pricks themselves and puts some blood drops in the urine after the child has voided it. So, what are the possibilities here? How do we approach? Make sure it is actually hematuria before you start evaluating. Is it a food that the child has taken that is changing the color of urine? What are the possibilities if it is food? Most common in our setting is beetroot and any food coloring or food dyes. Suppose the child says no, mother says no. Then is it something the child has consumed? Could it possibly be a drug? What are the drugs that we commonly use? Rifampicin, iron, desferrioxamine, adriamycin, metronidazole. Suppose the child says no, they have not taken any drugs either. Is the child having an underlying condition which is causing the child to excrete a metabolite that changes the color of urine? For example, in case of porphyria, urate crystals we often see in newborns, neonate pampers, or the diapers looking like blood in urine when it is actually urate crystals, melanin, methemoglobin, thyrocyanosis and homogentisic acid. And you definitely need to keep at the back of your mind Munchausen syndrome by proxy. So you suppose it is no to all the above questions. There is no food, there is nothing suggestive of excess metabolite, there is no history of consumption, then you have ruled out all these three causes. What is left out, whether it is actually RBCs or whether it is hemoglobin or myoglobin? How are we going to differentiate? Do a centrifuge of the urine. So when you spin the urine, see if the sediment is red or if the supernatant is red. If the sediment is red, then it is definitely RBCs because RBCs settle down. Suppose if the supernatant is red, what are the possibilities? You need to do a urine dipstick to determine if it is hemoglobin, myoglobin or neither of them. Before we jump into it, we will see what actually urine dipstick means. Okay, we will see it in the next slide. So you do a urine dipstick and the urine dipstick turns out to be positive. What it means? It means there is either hemoglobin or myoglobin. How are you going to differentiate that? Check the plasma color of the child's blood. If the plasma color is going to remain clear, it is myoglobinuria. If it is going to remain red, then it is hemoglobinuria. Myoglobinuria happens secondary to any crush injuries, secondary to any hypothermia injuries, any muscle injury basically. And you will definitely have a history. Whereas in hemoglobinuria, it is due to hemolysis. And there you can find associated symptoms and signs of hemolysis. Suppose the urine dipstick is going to be negative, It means that the child is having neither RBCs nor hemoglobin or myoglobin. So you need to look at your foods, your medications, and your metabolites. Urine dipstick basically tries to measure the RBCs or the hemoglobin, myoglobin by means of a chemical indicator which changes color. Usually the chemical indicator is tetramethylbenzidine. It detects 3 to 5 RBCs per microliter in uncentrifuged urine, okay, which roughly corresponds to 2 to 5 RBCs per high power field. So if it is going to detect, you know that there is definitely hematuria. Remember, there can always be false negatives and false positives. Suppose the dipstick is going to remain unchanged in the presence of hematuria. Possibilities are the urine was stored in some formalin based bottle, or the patient is taking excess amounts of ascorbic acid. Remember, it has false negative FA, formalin F, ascorbic acid A. False positives, without hematuria, the test is suggesting that the child is having one. It can happen whenever there is an alkaline urine or there is an oxidizing agent. Why oxidizing agent? Because the principle behind your urine dipstick is oxidizing, or it is using an oxidizing agent. So pH more than 8, or oxidizing agent like hydrogen peroxide, which can be used to clean the perineum before collection of sample. Positive PO, pH, and oxidizing agent. You can remember it like that. So you know roughly you have decided that this child is having actual hematuria or RBCs. So where can this blood come from? This blood can come from kidneys per se, below kidneys ureter, bladder, urethra, and in kidneys I have circled this part, which is the collecting pelvic ileal system. So the areas in the rectangles represent the lower urinary tract. In upper urinary tract, glomerulus, and in glomerulus it can happen anywhere in epithelium, basement membrane, endothelium, mesangium. It can happen in the collecting ducts, cortical collecting tubules. It can happen in the interstitium, which surrounds the loop of Henle, or it can be a vascular problem. It can vascular as in it can be a vessel wall problem, or the blood which goes inside the vessel problem. So there are these many causes that are possible. And not the least, where you are not able to actually specify the area from which the pathology is arising, meaning the whole kidney is involved, as in anatomical abnormalities like a polycystic kidneys, multicystic kidney disease, etc. So if you look at these causes by location, which is beautifully given in Nelson, it is really, really extensive. Remember the important causes, if not all. From glomeruli, we need to remember definitely a post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Apart from that, remember IgA, Alport's, thin basement membrane nephropathy. Rest all secondary to SLE, secondary to other systemic disorders, yes. Tubulointerstitium, it is interstitial nephritis and acute tubular necrosis. The whole kidney, anatomical diseases that we discussed, polycystic kidney, multicystic dysplasia, tumors, especially Wilms tumor, or it can be due to trauma. Lower urinary tract, anywhere from the pelvic ileal system, if there is an infection or inflammation, or if there is a stone anywhere in the system. If there is a cystitis, it can be secondary to infection or drugs. Infection, as in important for us to remember, is adenoviral. Drugs, cyclophosphamide. Bladder tumor, very less likely in kids. Trauma, always remember. Urethritis, yes. Systemic causes that can present as a kidney disease. Important to remember is SLE, SLE, SLE. Apart from that, Henoch-Schönlein purpura and hemolytic uremic syndrome. Vascular, it can be vasculitis that will come under the systemic diseases. The blood which goes inside, it can thrombose. There can be a hemoglobinopathy, or the vessel per se can be compressed. as in nutcracker syndrome, where the left renal vein gets compressed between aorta and mesenteric artery. So you know now the causes that can cause. But how do you know clinically where this blood is originating from? Anatomical is very nice to write in paper, but the child is not going to come with a, you know, 3D hologram saying the blood is originating in kidney or the blood is originating in ureter, etc. Is there any way that we can know? Yes, you need to sit with the child, ask history, do a proper examination, including blood pressure measurement. So what we need to differentiate, you need to know whether it is a renal disease or something else presenting as a renal disease. You need to know if it is originating in upper or lower urinary tract. And in upper urinary tract, whether it is glomerular or tubulointerstitial mesangial, etc. So whenever there is a systemic disease, you will have systemic symptoms. Ask if there is a past history of bleeding. Past history of bleeding, remember coagulopathy very, 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 very rarely presents as hematuria as the first symptom. Okay. If there is associated bleeding from other sites, yes, you can consider. Rash or arthritis, important for SLE, important for Henoch-Schönlein purpura. Ask if there is a loss of weight, loss of appetite associated. That can be part of any systemic illness. It can be a part of any malignancy. See if there is a pain crisis. Sickle cell can present with pain crisis earlier and can now come with hematuria. These are some pointers. It is not complete by any means. Upper versus lower urinary tract. See, usually lower urinary tract will have symptoms. Symptoms as in they usually are painful. If there is a flank pain without radiation, consider pyelonephritis. If there is a flank pain with radiation, consider stones. If there is symptoms of frequency, urgency, dysuria, it is generally very lower down as in bladder, urethra. If there is fresh blood or terminal hematuria, again it is bladder, urethra. And when you do a urine analysis, it will be an intact RBC and there will not be proteinuria. Next, it is glomerular versus extraglomerular. How are you going to know the difference? Glomerular generally has a cola colored urine, whereas extraglomerular as in tubulointerstitial has a bright red urine. Glomerular will have associated edema secondary to proteinuria. There can be hypertension, whereas extraglomerular may or may not have, and if at all it is going to be very minimal, and proteinuria is generally absent. Remember, RBC cast is a feature of glomerular hematuria, whereas blood clots is never from a glomerular location. It is always, always extraglomerular. The extraglomerular, I mean anything apart from glomerulus or after glomerulus. And glomerular hematuria will be deformed RBCs. What is significant glomerular hematuria? When you say significant, it means your urine analysis has 30% of dysmorphic RBCs or more than 5% are acanthocytes. Then you consider it as glomerular hematuria, not one or two deformed RBCs. Clear? Remember, glomerular hematuria, these are suggestive symptoms, and suppose these findings are not present in the child, you cannot rule out glomerular hematuria. But if these are present, it is suggestive of glomerular hematuria. So how to evaluate this child? Say now you have isolated it is from glomerulus or it is from tubulointerstitium or it is from lower urinary tract, etc. So how are you going to approach this child? Either the child is having gross hematuria or microscopic hematuria, isn't it so? Gross hematuria can be symptomatic or asymptomatic, and microscopic symptomatic or asymptomatic. Now don't ask me how will microscopic hematuria come as a symptomatic presentation, I'll tell you later. So a child who is coming to you with symptomatic hematuria, gross hematuria. Symptoms of trauma, if it is obvious, yes, you know this child has had a trauma, probable renal injury, so you will go ahead with a CT abdomen and pelvis. Suppose the history is suggestive of a glomerular cause, like the child is coming in with edema, the child is having hypertension, you are seeing that the child is having cola colored urine, then important investigations will be directed towards identifying post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis and SLE. It is important to ask history in case you want to differentiate between IgA nephropathy and PSGN. Okay. So, your respiratory tract symptoms will be 2 to 3 days prior in IgA nephropathy, whereas it will be 2 to 3 weeks prior in a post-streptococcal glomerulonephritis. Remember that point. If there are features suggestive of lower urinary tract symptoms like dysuria, urgency, frequency, start with a local examination. See if there is any urethritis. See if there is any perineal inflammation. See if there are any adhesions. Rule out UTI. Do an ultrasound abdomen to look at the bladder to rule out cystitis. Suppose that is also not there, then do a complete examination of the child to look for a mass. If you feel there is a mass present, do an ultrasound abdomen and then proceed accordingly, according to whatever you find in your ultrasound. Next, if history is suggestive of nephrolithiasis, there is a pain that is radiating to different parts, you're suspecting, start with the ultrasound abdomen and x-ray. Why both? Because there are both radiolucent and radioopaque stones. If you do just one investigation, you may miss out on the other. The ideal investigation will be a spiral CT. With this, you'll be able to narrow down what might be causing this child's gross hematuria, which is symptomatic. Next, you're coming to a child who's complaining that the child is having blood in urine but not having any symptoms. Evaluations or studies have shown nearly 30 to 40% you don't find any cause at all in these cases of asymptomatic gross hematuria. And when they do find a cause, it is usually idiopathic hypercalciuria and IgA nephropathy. Idiopathic hypercalciuria, for us to diagnose, you need to do urine calcium creatinine ratio more than 0.2. More than 0.2 is in more than 6 years. Age-based values are important. IgA nephropathy can remain asymptomatic microscopic hematuria, asymptomatic gross hematuria, or it can progress to form a chronic kidney disease. It can have varied presentations. If the child is having features suggestive of IgA nephropathy, like the child is having some amount of proteinuria in your evaluation, some amount of raised serum creatinine, do a RFT and follow up the child accordingly. If the child has none of these features, the child is asymptomatic, still keep PSGN at the back of your mind and evaluate with ASO levels, C3 levels, etc. Then look for benign familial hematuria or thin glomerular basement membrane disease, where there may or may not be a family history of hematuria. Okay, but the prognosis is fairly good and you just need to follow up the kid. Next, nutcracker syndrome. Nutcracker syndrome, it may be underdiagnosed in our settings because we generally don't suspect it. As we already discussed, it is the left renal vein which is compressed between the aorta and superior mesenteric artery. There, it can be symptomatic with flank pain also, and diagnosis will be by your Doppler ultrasonography. Next, microscopic hematuria and symptomatic microscopic hematuria. Symptoms as in the child is coming in with history. When you do a urine examination, you incidentally find out this child is also having hematuria. The evaluation will be very similar to that of your gross hematuria, apart from including your asymptomatic gross hematuria investigations. Okay. Next, this is the tricky child, where there is microscopic hematuria, the child is asymptomatic, and you incidentally find out there is something wrong. Now, this is a rider for us. If left undetected, the child might have gone on happily with his or her life. But now that you have found out something, you have opened this Pandora's box. So, you need to evaluate this child to reassure yourself, to reassure the parents that this is either something or this is nothing. So, divide it into isolated microscopic hematuria, or whether it is associated with proteinuria, because the evaluation is different. Suppose this child is having just hematuria, which is microscopic. It is usually transient and there will be no associated systemic disorders. But you need to make sure that there is no associated systemic illness before declaring it to the parents. So how do you do that? You do that by repeated testing. So you do weekly twice testing for 2 weeks and tell the child that there should be no exercise 48 hours prior, because exercise can induce transient hematuria. And you do a urine analysis weekly twice. And what do you see? If it is a normal urine analysis, reassure and follow up only as required. Suppose you are finding hematuria and proteinuria also, then follow the flow chart to proteinuria, which I will be discussing later. Suppose you are again finding this microscopic hematuria, do a complete history examination including BP. In history and examination, you are going to look for all the causes of hematuria that are possible in this child. Suppose everything is normal, your history is not suggestive, examination is not giving you any clues, your blood pressure is normal, do a urine culture sensitivity. Okay. Suppose it is showing some findings, then this child is a symptomatic microscopic hematuria, because this child is having some symptoms like hypertension or some symptoms like edema, etc. Suppose this child is having normal everything, normal history, normal examination, normal blood pressure, do a urine culture sensitivity even in an asymptomatic child. If it is going to be abnormal, you are going to be treating this child for a UTI. Suppose this child is normal, do every 3 months evaluation of history, examination, your urine analysis, blood pressure examination. Suppose this child is resolving, then you are happy. Suppose this child is not resolving and there is persistence of hematuria and only hematuria more than 1 year, you will refer to a pediatric nephrologist. What are they going to look for? They will evaluate this child for mainly idiopathic hypercalciuria, familial hematuria, rare causes like sickle cell trait and nutcracker syndrome. Suppose this child is turning out to be symptomatic, or in the course of the period the child is developing some proteinuria, some hypertension, then you will follow respective algorithms. Now this is a child who has come with microscopic hematuria and proteinuria. So what did we discuss earlier? Proteinuria, think of glomerular causes. Okay. So there is definite glomerular involvement and you need to know if this kidney is failing or not. How are you going to do that? To ascertain whether it is glomerular and whether it is significant, you are going to do a protein evaluation. You will do a protein creatinine ratio or a 24 hour protein, urine protein levels. And you will do a serum creatinine. Suppose this child is having a significant proteinuria or elevated creatinine, either of those, then you will refer to a pediatric nephrologist who will rule out causes one by one. Say this child is having just minimal proteinuria and normal creatinine, both should be present. If both are there, follow up the child 3 weeks later. And when you are doing, if the child is normal, then nothing needs to be done, just follow up the child only as and when required. Suppose hematuria persists, you will follow this child as per the algorithm in asymptomatic microscopic hematuria, which is isolated. Suppose if both proteinuria and hematuria are persisting, again you will refer this child to a nephrologist. Clear? When will you do a renal biopsy? Now you have done all this. Do we still need to do a renal biopsy? Only in very few settings a renal biopsy will be indicated. Suppose this child is having a family history of hematuria and there are family members who are progressing to end stage renal disease or requiring dialysis at a young age, then you need to find out the cause early so that you can treat this child early. So you will go ahead and do a renal biopsy. Or the signs and symptoms are suggestive of a progressive renal disease in your investigation, like rising blood pressure when all other investigations look normal. You have raising creatinine or persistent significant proteinuria in the background of a hematuria, then you consider a renal biopsy to know the cause. I hope I have tried to simplify this topic of hematuria for all of you, and hope that you will be able to approach a kid with hematuria in your clinical practice and also be able to write short notes or long notes if such a question is asked. If you like the content of my channel, please subscribe, hit the bell icon next to it so that you get notifications whenever I post a video. And distribute or share this channel with your friends and your colleagues and juniors and seniors so that they can also benefit from the lectures. Thank you all once again. I've given my references in this slide.